TVHams.com is the official website of the Gentleman Grochowski Show. You can also go to Facebook and YouTube. Check out YouTube for past videos. You can go to Facebook and just see what's going on our fan page. And then the main hub of them all, TVHams.com. We happen to have a comedian, a actor, an improviser. I don't want to, what's wrong with improvabilist?
Improvabilist means that I went to a Catholic improv school.
Yeah.
So I didn't. So I went to public improv school, so I'm an improviser.
Improviser, but okay. I like how that sounds. He's an improvabilist. Even though I don't even know that
the church will get upset.
That they will get ready?
They will come after me.
Okay. A couple 10 Hail Marys, I guess.
That's right.
Like that. Josh Blair, how are you, Josh? Welcome to broadcast.
I'm excited. I have like cameras all over.
Yeah,
I get to talk about myself. I get to look at myself. This is my type of evening. Yeah.
Living the dream now.
I'm living the dream right now.
Living the dream. I got you. So, well, anyway, so you started off with improv, right?
Yes.
Tell us about, for people people at home, improv and an improvalist. We already discovered what an improvalist is, but let's tell us, people, really what improv is. What is the art of improv?
The art of improv is a form of theater and acting, and I know I'm butchering this definition, but it's the idea of self-creation, creating live on stage. So where you can go see Romeo and Juliet or a modern play like Book of Mormon, and there's a script, there's music, there's this and that. Improv can be anything. It's what you're creating. It's taking one idea and just shooting off in different directions.
Could you imagine Romeo and Juliet improv? It'd be different every night. It'd be a different ending, right?
Why don't we find out right now?
Yeah, I mean, I'm saying that would be perfect for
yes.
to keep people coming back because you don't know how it's going to end tonight.
Exactly.
It's going to end differently. How is it going to end?
Right. So if I'm like, Romeo, what's going on?
Oh, I'm doing good. How you doing, girl?
See? Juliet dumps Romeo because Juliet don't play that.
Why?
It's like, girl, you know her name.
Well,
she's a Capulet.
I know, but, you know, he's a dog. Come on. I think that's how it would be. I don't know. Something would be interesting. So there's a lot more to this man, believe it or not, than meets the eye. He actually has a college degree, went to DePaul.
DePaul, Chicago.
He's a blue demon.
Yes. Just about anything you can do in Chicago, I've done it. I've eaten hot dogs. I've gone to DePaul. I went to Chicago Public Schools. And now I'm doing comedy.
There you go.
In the mecca of comedy, Chicago.
I tell you what, Chicago has its roots in comedy.
Yes.
It's some roots for...
Exactly.
I guess it was Second City, Players Workshop, and everything from back in the day.
Absolutely. Going back to the 50s.
And you are also a graduate of Second City.
Yes.
And the conservatory.
Yes, I graduated the Second City Conservatory this past May 2015, almost. Mm-hmm. Been a year.
Yeah.
It was a dream of mine to go there and go into the conservatory program because you have to audition for it. You have to kind of earn your spot there.
Okay.
So I made it. Third time.
Oh, okay.
But you have to audition to stay in there, and they didn't kick me out. So that, to me, is the bigger accomplishment. And I finished the program, and I got my little piece of paper with my name that says, I know what I'm doing, sort of.
A bunch of paranoid people walking around there, like, they're going to kick me out, you know?
Oh, yeah.
You think that or no?
There were days.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's with any actor. There's a level of insecurity with anything, because, like, with acting and improv, it's never solid. It's you go from gig to gig. You're independent. You're freelance. So
Right. There's
always that moment of like, how long is this gravy train going to go? How long am I going to keep doing this? Am I going to go any further? Is it going to get worse? So there's always that slight insecurity, I think, with every actor. It's how you manage it that makes the difference.
Now, in addition to being an actor and dealing with improv, you also have a podcast.
Yes, I am the producer and one of the wonderful co-hosts of Smeared Ink,
okay.
An improvised podcast. And it's Smeared Ink, INC, instead of INK, because, as you know, with improv, you need to have, like, a punny name.
Right, okay, I gotcha.
So I host that with two of my best friends, Kate and Sean, who... we've been on the show with you guys before, but they couldn't be here because they don't like you.
What?
No, I'm kidding.
I thought it was like, somebody got a new jacket?
I said...
You told them about the new jacket was
and they're
coming
like,
out, right?
Yeah, I said, look at how he looks. And they're like, I can't be next to Mr. Prima Donna. That was Sean's words.
I only did that once. I only did that once, okay?
If you think that's rude, tweet at S. Patrick Conroy.
Okay.
Send your hate mail there. But, yeah, we've been hosting that show going on 2 years.
Okay.
We just hit a milestone 50th episode last month where we did our first live show, at the Champaign Urbana Improv Festival. That was in November.
Road trip, absolutely.
Hotels. The day's in. Exciting.
You lived it up? Did you trash it like a rock star?
Oh, we left it clean and full of
garbage. What is that all about?
We're nice people. We're good Midwestern people. But we've been doing the podcast for years, had a lot of interesting guests. And, you know, you get the opportunity to do this comedy show where you're sitting around with your friends for like an hour of working with people you love, and you know, people, you put it out there and people listen to it and they tell you they like it.
Oh, is it hard to be an audio improviser? Improviser, I got it right. An improviser, an audio improviser, or is it, because you improvise, you know, you're on stage, right?
Right.
You got gifts, you know, you got, you're moving things,
yes,
stuff going on. With which is a podcast, which is your ear. How do you just improvise with that?
I think it goes back to like you know, listening to radio shows and things of that nature. You think of like the language you're using. You use more descriptive language when you're on audio, because occasionally, and those who go back and listen to our show will notice early on the episodes, we at times were like reminding each other, this is an audio show, because we're like, oh, you know, so there I was and I hit this thing as I was driving down the road and it was like this. We're here, and we're like, it's like that. But I'm like, it's like this. And listeners are like what?
Oh, so you're more descriptive.
Right. So it's a muscle in a way. Like, the same way it's like you adjust for different audiences. The way, you know, you do a show for a church group or senior citizens is different how you do a show on the north side at 11 o'clock at night. You just kind of adjust for your audience. And with audio shows, it's just another category.
Okay. Now, when you did the live show, was it the 50th episode, you said?
Yes.
How was it different from doing it in the regular studio where you regularly recorded at?
Well, we were wearing pants, for one.
Oh, okay.
So that's the first thing. No, we were all dressed nice. We had a nice crowd. The Champaign Urbana Improv Festival was put on by their improv theater, Zoo Improv. And what was kind of different was, where we're sitting around a table talking, you know, goofing around. We did a little bit of that, but what we did to kind of mix it up is we did a short-form improv show, the type of show we would do if we were just there to perform and to act. But we leaned on games that have the benefit of you could listen to them without seeing a video.
Okay.
So, like, short-form improv games, like the improv game New Choice, where you have a bell, and I can ring a bell, and one of the actors has to take back what they said and put in something new. So, like, for a radio show, it's like,
perfect.
Oh, okay, exactly.
Because it's just audio.
You
can hear that.
Exactly. More of a game aspect to the scenes.
I understand that.
Yeah.
And you said you work with Covered Bridge Productions.
Yes, I am an assistant director there now. I was an actor there for like the last 3 years, and I still am, as needed. They're the a theater group in Tinley Park, Illinois. They have their own improv team, and I was an improviser with them, still am, and have had the opportunity to assistant direct their last few reviews. So it's kind of like fun to be able to kind of direct and teach now.
What is different between being a director of an improv show opposed to being in the improv show?
I think the biggest thing, and you can tell with like your teachers and your directors, whether you're on that side or as the actor, is you have to understand as an improviser, the answer I might have in my head for where a scene should go isn't always the best answer. So where it's like, you know, we'll try this scene and there's the situation. I might see one of my actors do something entirely different than I would have thought of. I'm like, that's pretty good. Or if I'm like, what if you did this? Or this is where you shut your partner off. There's the critiquing aspect is hard because you have to get out of the mindset of this is what Josh thought would have been funnier versus this is just how you would better stage something, because those are two different things.
Okay. Malnikoff and Blair.
Yeah, Malnikoff and Blair is my two-person improv team, and I guess production team now, because we actually have our first show coming up in May.
Okay.
We've been performing together for about a year and a half now as a duo for about a year. Did various shows at the Second City Training Center, IO, Underground Lounge, and continue to do show. We rewrite sketches and do improv, and we kind of started writing a show, pitched it to the Second City Training Center, and got picked up for their DeMont Theater in May.
Oh, excellent. That sounds cool.
Yeah.
Excited about it?
It's exciting, and it's nerve-wracking, because this is the first project for the both of us, really, where it's like we're in complete control, you know, 99% without a net. Like, you know, we put shows together in school, and, you know, you always have a teacher, you always have the school helping you out, the training center. I've been an assistant director, and it's like, I was assistant director, I wasn't running the whole thing, and then you're an improviser, an actor, you just have to worry about what you bring into the table. Here, it's like, you have to worry about marketing, you have to worry about what's going to get people to come to your show, because it's like, I can have a really funny show, and I'm not saying to be overconfident, I'm just saying, theoretically, I can have a great show.
Right.
I got to get butts in those seats, though, because if I have a great show and no one's there to see it, that's the thing.
All right, right.
Believe second city. No.
Well, it's just like doing anything. You gotta have an audience.
Exactly.
You gotta get the audience.
Exactly.
If there's no audience, you could be the best.
Yeah.
Of edit, and no one's there. No one knows about it.
Right. And then the other part being, once you have an audience, that audience has to come back the next
right.
week
and rave about it. Yeah.
Yeah. Or at least get their friends to come.
Yeah. Now you do work for a nonprofit workshop.
This is actually, I just started working with them, Room to Improv, roomtoimprov.com, because I'm not going to do justice in my description. I've literally been with them a couple weeks. It's a non-for-profit that is bringing like improv to the masses. They work with like a lot of clients in the Midwestern area, Illinois area primarily, I'd say. And it's about bringing the art of improv to corners of the world that don't have it. Because, you know, besides the fun of being an improviser, an actor, and a comedian, you know, stuff that you know, it's like, think of people that never think about performing, never think about doing their own show. What's the benefit of improv? It's the team building, it's the building confidence, you know. I actually got into improv to build my confidence because I was like a quiet, introverted, this type of person.
So he was a shy.
I was a very shy person.
Wow.
Yeah. Like I was one of those guys, it's like, if I could avoid having conversation, that's exactly what I would do.
Okay.
And someone suggested to me, for one of the many benefits, you know, take an improv class. You'll meet some new people, make some new friends. And I've made a lot of great new friends, people that I consider family. And it made me come out of my shell. And I think for a lot of people, it does. Even if they are introverted people, even, you know, at the most, they get something out of it. They grow as a person.
Okay. So a couple of years ago, if I would have put you in that green room with that cast of characters in there, you would have been, like, just probably, like, scared to be in it now. A
couple of years, I would have been good. 4 years ago, no, I'd be wandering around the hallway.
Yeah.
I'd be like, when do we get started? Why are you interviewing me? Because I'm not an interesting person.
And then who are these people?
Yeah,
right?
Who are these people? Yeah.
Okay. And one quick thing. Sex ain't love.
Ah, so you've been spying on my IMDb.
I did a little bit. But you know what? I usually say that to the girls. It's sex ain't love, baby girl. I'm saving myself.
And now you know why Romeo...
Huh?
That's why Romeo didn't get with Juliet.
Well, they kill each other, didn't they?
Now they do.
Right? What do they do in the play?
No, they kill each other.
They drank some potions or something, right?
Right.
It was a cocktail or what was that?
It was poison.
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 They wanted to die or they both kill each other? I forgot how
I
that
think,
ended.
I think, what was it? Juliet thought Romeo killed himself or he was dead.
Right.
Or no, Juliet was faking her death. Romeo believed it and it's like, oh, she's dead. I may as well off myself. And then Juliet wakes up and is like, oh.
No good.
Bad planning.
You like superheroes, huh?
Oh, I'm wearing a Daredevil t-shirt.
Yeah, well,
yes.
I saw some of your pictures.
Yes.
And you got a lot of comic book characters referenced in those pictures.
Yes, I am a comic book geek. That's probably been my longest passion. You know, going to cartoons and comic books. My dad was a big comic book reader, so it's like, here, read these. And you're like, oh, these are amazing.
Yeah.
So, you know, now you live in the generation where there's movies and everything, superheroes, TV shows. It's like a renaissance for geeks.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
So you've also made some appearances at Comic-Con.
Yes, I have been going to Comic-Con. I was trying to figure it out the other day. I think since I was about 12 or 13. I know at least from high school on.
Okay.
You know, at first spending your parents' money. You know, I need money to buy this book or this statue or this toy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like a teenager talking.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you get to your 20s and you're like, now I'm spending my money.
Oh.
And then you're getting a little bit older. I'm like, I can't keep spending this money, but I'm not going to stop.
Now, yeah, Comic-Con, it sounds like a fun. I actually want to go there. It's the first time because I've seen people go there over the years and I've never been there. But I'm like, that's got to be fun, just dressing up as human beings. And I'm going to dress up as a human being, dress up as superheroes.
Yeah, there you go.
And you dress up as Captain America.
Yeah, I dressed up as Captain America last year. It was great because in Chicago it was a nice rainy day, so I used my expensive shield to block the rain.
Got to be practical.
And it was fun because that was actually the same time the Chicago Improv Festival was going on. And I was stage managing at Second City, and I ended up having to do part of that night in my Captain America costume.
Oh, there you
go. So I'm running around telling people what to do, and it's like, why is this guy dressed up like Captain America?
You do what you want, because I
exactly.
want to. Because it's America, and I'm the captain, right?
Yeah, see?
Yeah, there you go. But I'm punch. Okay, tell us about you got improv. You got improv. You got Instagram and you got Twitter.
Yes, at that Josh Blair, at THAT Josh Blair. That's where you can find me on Instagram and Twitter. I have a couple Facebook pages, facebook.com/Melnikoff and Blair. And if you search Josh Blair, it'll come up. Same with our Smeared Ink page, which you can find on iTunes, Stitcher, wherever podcasts are given away. And that's a good place to get in touch with me, you know, find out the things that I'm working on. I also have a blog, overweighthero.blogger.com.
There you go.
Where I talk about dieting and things like that.
Everyone's got to diet. Even superheroes have to diet.
Yeah, absolutely.
You gotta watch their diet.
Absolutely.
And then tell us real quick about the sampler.
The sampler, so the SC sampler is its name right now, SC referring to Second City. It's coming to the Second City Training Center in May.
The DeMont Theater.
The DeMont Theater.
Yes, you gotta say it professional.
It's gonna be a professional run at the DeMont Theater this upcoming spring.
Yes.
Every Saturday at 7. Information will be on the Second City Training Center website and our Facebook page. It's a variety show, kind of the style of The Tonight Show, where myself and my partner, Sammy Melnikoff.
There you go.
Where it's a Tonight Show style thing where we have sketches we've written. We're going to feature guests that are doing other shows at the Second City Training Center, hence the sampler. And then we wrap it up with live music every week. And actually, Sammy, who is a professional musician, we're trying to coax her into doing one of those musical slots.
There you go. Excellent. All right. Josh, thanks for stopping by. Josh Blair. For more information about Josh, you can also go to TVHams.com, the official website of The Gentleman Grochowski Show, Facebook, and on YouTube.
It's The Gentleman Grochowski Show. Everybody, don't you know? Boom, boom, boom. It's The Gentleman Grochowski Show. Everybody, don't you know? It's The Gentleman Grochowski Show. Everybody, don't you know? It's the Gentleman Grochowski Show!